Send the stuff deliver. Like this. Okay. Voltage is given to be inverting input terminal, and non-inverting input terminal is given with the voltage across the resistor out. Somebody's on the line. Okay, here we go. Okay, that's the difference. So in this case, since the reference voltage is AC, the reference voltage will change as the output voltage will change. As the output voltage switches between two saturation levels, reference voltage will also change. Accordingly, the triggering point will also change. You know, there is the upper triggering point and what is known as a lower triggering point. Upper triggering point is of course positive because it corresponds to positive voltage, positive output voltage. Lower triggering point corresponds to negative output voltage. Okay. So in the 0% detector, reference voltage is DC, which is fixed. Okay, so it does not change. I mean, it will not be like positive or negative DC, not like that. It can be changed, no doubt. 0% detector, of course, so the reference voltage is zero. Level detector, reference voltage is positive or negative DC. It varies. It varies according to the position of the potentiometer, which selects the positive DC or negative DC. Okay, fine. So let us look into the, this hysteresis waveform also we saw in the last class. That is, as the output voltage switches the level, there is a saturation level, the UTP and LTP also changes. Accordingly, it will generate the output voltage. Output voltage is always a square pulse. Okay? Output voltage cannot be of any other size. It has to be rectangular pulse. To be more specific, it is a rectangular pulse. Okay. Okay, so design is very simple. We have only two resistors to select, R1 and R2. How do we select? Very simple. Based on the current, this current I2. I2 is flowing through R1 and R2. Because this current I2, the I2 dash, let us call it as I2 dash, which is the input bias current flowing into the non-inverting input terminal. This is in terms of nanoamperes, maximum 500 nanoamperes. So it's very small, and hence, maximum current can be assumed to flow through R1 and R2. Okay, so based on the current flow through R1 and R2, we can select the values of resistor R1 and R2. Okay, so to select the resistor, so based on the voltage across R2 and based on the current flowing through R2, we are going to decide the value of R2. Okay, so the design is given here. So for R2, okay, so what is the voltage across R2? Is it is a triggering voltage. This is VR2. Okay, so based on this VR2, we can find out the value of R2. That means based on the triggering voltage required. Let us say, for example, VR2 is supposed to be 2 volts. That is a plus 2 volts. There is positive triggering point. That is a UTP. And LTP is, let us say, for example, minus 2 volts LTP. So based on the voltage given, we can find out the value of R2. And for a given value of current, current depends on the type of op amp, that we have discussed earlier, because as the op amp changes, the input bias current also changes. Okay, so R2 is given as triggering voltage divided by I2. What about R1? See, for R1, what happens is that voltage across R1 is difference of the V2 and V0. That is, if you see the R1, at one end of R1, there is V0 output voltage, and another end of R1 is VR2. Of course, VR1 is derived from V0, but V0 is greater than VR2. VR2, and then for R1 voltage difference across R1, that is V0 minus VR2, divided by the current I2, because R is equal to V by I. So V is the voltage difference across R1 divided by current I2. Very simple. Okay, so V0 minus triggering voltage, in the diagram it is VR2 voltage across R2. We can also call it as UTP triggering. That's why the author suggests it as a triggering voltage. In general terms, you can take it as plus or minus triggering voltage, that is plus UTP or minus LTP. Minus LTP. Okay. So that's how we can select the value of R2. Okay. So for BFET op amp, what happens? The usual procedure is to select the largest of the two resistors. Okay. out of R1 and R2, select the largest resistor. So from this we will get to know, we'll get an idea which one is greater, whether R1 is greater than R2 or R1 is less than R2. Based on that, the largest resistor is selected as 1 mega ohm for a BFET operator. Other one is calculated from the formula. Okay, so that is for the BFET, because BFET op amp input resistance should be very high. So that's why the that procedure is followed for the BFET op amp. So for a 741 op amp, for a biasing voltage of plus or minus 12 volts, inverting split trigger circuit designed for a triggering point of plus or minus 2 volts. That is UTP is plus 2 volts, and LTP is minus 2 volts. LTP is minus 2 volts. Okay. Again, the same assumption is I2 is greater than IB max, at least 100 times IB max. Same assumption, 100 times IB max. So 100 times 500 nanoamperes for a 741 op amp, it gives 50 microamperes. Okay, so from that VR2 is UTP, upper triggering point. For a output voltage positive, VR2 is positive, that is UTP. So from that, R2 is 2 voltage divided by I2, that is 50 microamperes. So which gives 40 So R2 is 40 kilo ohm. Closer value, again from the standard resistor table, let us not look into the table again, it takes up. Okay, so it's 32 kilo ohms. What about I2 is? I2 is VR2 divided by, okay. Now since R2 is changed, this R2 will affect I2, and as I2 has to be recalculated, I2 is equal to, from the same formula, I2 is equal to VR2 by R2, it is around 51.3 microamperes. Okay, so using this as the current, we have to find out the value of R2. Okay, so for R1, so for VR1 is VR1 voltage across R1 is saturation voltage minus VR2. Saturation voltage is always 1 volt less than the biasing voltage, usually the case. It may not be the case always, but in most of the cases the saturation voltage is 1 volt less than the bias voltage. For example, if you take biasing voltage as plus or minus 15 volts, it will be 15 volts minus 1 volt, very simple. Okay, minus triggering voltage, that is UTP and LTP, that is 2 volts. So VR1 is 9 volts. Okay, so guess from this, what is the value of R1? Guess, in fact, it is given, there's a printing mistake here. It is not R2, it is R1. Okay, so R1 is equal to VR2 divided by I2 voltage across R. triggering voltage. Okay, fine. VR1 is counted from here only, correct. Okay, so this is again VR1. There is a mistake here in the textbook. It is VR1. R1 is equal to VR1 divided by I2. Okay, so 9 voltage divided by I2 is the recalculated value of current. It is 51.3 microamperes. It gives around 175 kilo ohms. So again, the closer standard value is 180 kilo ohms. Okay, so based on that, we can select the standard value. Okay, so this is the final design of a split trigger. In any numerical problem, you have to calculate the values of these unknown components. You have to write the complete diagram, and you have to enter the values. So that will fetch you the few marks, because circuit diagram should complete the picture. Okay. So this is very, very important. Okay? Write the circuit diagram and enter the values. Okay? For theory questions, anyway, you have to write. For problems also, you have to write the circuit diagram and you have to enter the values like this. See, for example, R1, R2, and biasing voltage, plus or minus 12 volts. Okay? So these things you have to write. Okay, here we go. Adjusting the triggering points. Okay? Now, how to adjust? See, triggering point varies. Triggering point depends on the output voltage. Output voltage is varying between positive and negative saturation voltage. Accordingly, the triggering point also varies. But for a given output voltage, triggering point remains constant. For example, UTP will always be, let's say, for example, plus 2 volts in our earlier numerical problem, 2 volts. LTP remains minus 2 volts. This will not change for a given value of R1 and R2, for a given value of R1. Now, let us say the question here is, we don't want the triggering value to be equal, or we want to continuously change. How to do that? Okay. So for that, we go for what is known as a adjustable triggering point arrangement. Okay, here we go. So for adjustable triggering point arrangement, so for adjustable triggering point, to adjust the triggering points, okay, that is upper and lower triggering points, can be made equal. But it may not always be desirable. Sometimes we want UTP which is not equal to LTP. In this situation, we have to make UTP different from LTP, okay, based on the requirement. One common requirement is to have some positive level of UTP combined with zero voltage as LTP. That means what the author is trying to say here is, just a second, somebody. Okay. So that means UTP is some fixed value, let us say for example 2 volts in this case. For example, UTP is 2 volts, that's fine, okay. But LTP should be 0 volts. LTP, we don't want minus 2. In normal case, if UTP is 2 volts, LTP will be minus 2 volts. But we want something else. How to adjust this, okay? So that is adjustable triggering point arrangement, okay. Okay, so UTP is different from LTP. For example, LTP can be zero. This can be achieved by using additional diodes in series with R1. Okay, as illustrated. Okay, let's jump to the diagram. Okay, so let's discuss with the diagrams. Okay, something like this. Very simple. Okay, a resistor is connected in series with the diode D1. Okay, diode D1 in this position will make. Okay, for example, let's say output is positive saturation. Okay, output is positive saturation. Diode D1 is forward bias. Diode D1 forward bias, there is a voltage drop across R2, VR2. VR2 exists. Let us say VR2 is equal to, for example, 2 volts. Just like what we had in our earlier program, VR2 is 2 volts. When the output voltage switches to negative saturation, then diode D1 is reverse biased. When diode D1 is reverse biased, output voltage does not exist. Of course, see, output voltage exists. Output voltage is negative saturation. But voltage across VR2 is 0. Why? Because there is no current through R2 is 0. I2 will become 0, 0 amperes. Because of that, VR2 becomes 0. VR2 becomes 0 volts. Okay. That means using this diode, we got only UTP. UTP is equal to, let us say, for example, 2 volts, for example, for our understanding purpose. But LTP becomes 0. LTP becomes 0. LTP becomes 0. Okay. So diode D1 gives LTP 0. But it gives UTP. Okay. Fine. Now, how to adjust both, that is how to adjust both the, how to make UTP different from LTP, UTP not equal to LTP. Very simple. Use two diodes, D1 and D2, with series resistance R1 and R3. If R1 is not equal to R3, if R1 is different from R3, then we will be able to achieve UTP and LTP, which are different. Now, what is the situation here is very simple. Output voltage positive saturation, for example, diode D1 is forward bias, UTP is given by the resistances R1 and R2. R1 and R2 gives UTP from the same design procedure. Okay, negative saturation voltage, diode D2 is forward bias, diode D1 is reverse biased, then LTP is given by the series combination of resistor R3 and R2. Resistor R3 and R2. If R1 and R3 are different, then we'll be able to achieve different levels for UTP and LTP. That is lower triggering point and upper triggering point. Very simple. Okay? So that's what explained here. Okay. So, but what is the condition on the diodes? Okay, the same thing is explained here. Okay. So till this point, the same thing is explained. The condition on diode is that it must be selected based on the fact that maximum reverse voltage to be greater than the circuit supply voltage. For example, if the circuit supply voltage is, let us say, plus or minus 50 volts, circuit supply voltage is less or minus 50 volts, then this diodes should have a reverse blocking voltage VR greater than the supply voltage. There is a plus or minus VCC, plus or minus VCC. Okay, so that it can withstand the reverse voltage. Because see, for example, for a positive cycle, diode D2 is reverse biased. When diode D2 is reverse biased, biasing voltage is plus 15 volts and minus 15 volts. So saturation voltage will be plus 14 volts and minus 14 volts. Okay. So when the diode D2 is reverse biased, the supply voltage will appear across the diode. Okay. Plus 14 volt will appear across the diode D2. So D2 should be able to withstand this reverse voltage. Okay. So that we have to take care of. That is one condition. The other condition for the selection of diode is that the maximum reverse recovery time should be much smaller than the minimum pulse width of the input signal. This we discussed earlier, you know. For example, if the minimum pulse width of the input signal, for example, okay, minimum pulse width, let us say TR is the pulse width. Let me call it as TP, not TR, TP. Then this pulse width of the input signal is TP. Then reverse recovery time should be such that it should be very much smaller compared to TP. Why? Because when the input changes the state, the output also changes the state. Accordingly, the diode should be fast enough to switch between positive saturation and negative saturation. Okay. So if the reverse recovery time is very small, in other words, switching speed, if the switching speed of the diodes is very, very fast, then it is better. So output will be able to switch at a faster rate. Otherwise, output will be distorted. Okay. So minimum reverse recovery time should be at least 1/10 of the pulse width. Okay. That is TP by 10. At least TRR should be equal to TP by 10. At least 1/10. Even smaller than this is also better. So we can go for Schottky diodes. Schottky diodes are faster diodes. So we can make use of Schottky diodes as a diode selection for the for the circuit, so that switching speed of the diode will be faster. So diode forward current should be at least 100 microamperes. Okay, so because 500 microamperes is the maximum, all 500 microamperes is the minimum, might be more special because larger. Okay, what will happen here is, let's observe this. This current, we assume it to be we assume it to be at least 100 times that of IB max, that is 500 nanoamperes. Okay. If the forward current is very small, what will happen is the current flowing through R1 and R2 is very small. If the current through R1 and R2 is very small, then we have to select R1 and R2 as a larger current. Larger resistance. We have to select larger value for R1 and R2. Larger the value of R1 and R2, there's a larger power dissipation in the entire circuit. Okay. So thereby, we have to select diodes in such a way that the current through these diodes, when they are forward biased, should be very large current. So at least 500 nanoampere should be ideal, you know. Larger the current, better is the power dissipation of the circuit. Better in the sense, smaller the resistance, better is the power dissipation. Okay? So minimum 500 ampere is better for the forward current of a diode. Okay. So circuit, two different levels, triggering point is obtained, different duty pendulum is possible. So when the output is positive, okay, the same thing is explained. So how it is affected, okay? UTP is when the output is positive. When the output is positive, D2 is reverse biased, D1 is forward biased. Then the voltage across R2 is given as V0 minus VF, okay? That is forward volt. Okay, let's observe this. This is one more point, okay? That is, in this case, that is this formula, guys. You know, VR2 is here somewhere. Here it is. Okay, VR2. This one. Okay, there is voltage across R2 is triggering voltage divided by I2. Okay, but now along with the triggering voltage, we also have the diode forward voltage. Observe this in this circuit. Okay. Voltage across R2, VR2, okay, is, for this, we have to consider the forward voltage of diode D1, because this point is V0, this point is VF. VF is forward voltage drop of a diode, this point is VR2. If we consider this network, this complete network, okay, the voltage is Vf plus Vr2. Vf plus Vr2 is equal to V0. Is equal to, let me, okay, is equal to V0 saturation. V0 saturation. Earlier, in the absence of diode, the equation was V0 saturation is equal to Vr2. V0 saturation is equal to Vr2. Okay. Now it is equal to Vr2 plus Vf. That is because of the forward voltage drop of the diode. Either for the positive saturation or for the negative saturation. Positive saturation, diode D1 is forward biased. For the negative saturation, diode D2 is forward biased. Okay. So we have to consider this that condition. Accordingly, we have to select the values of the resistors and voltage. Okay, so there is Vr2 is equal to V0 minus Vf. It is actually minus, you know, it is not visible here. Minus Vf into R2, voltage across R2, divided by sum of resistance R1 plus R2. Okay, right. That is UTP. Similarly, LTP, Vr2, voltage across R2, is now due to diode D1 is reverse biased, diode D2 is forward biased. Because of that, this factor remains the same because forward voltage is always Vf. So V0 minus Vf into R2 divided by R3. Now R3 comes into picture. So for UTP R1, R1 and R2 is in series. For LTP and UTP, for UTP D1 is forward biased. For LTP D2 is forward biased, and R3 and R2 are in series. Yes, okay. So that's the design selection for the design method for the UTP and LTP. There is upper triggering point and the lower triggering points. Okay, here we go. Okay, yes, this is with respect to inverting symmetrical circuit. Next is the non-inverting symmetrical circuit. Okay, so what is the difference here is, in the non-inverting symmetrical circuit, input voltage is applied to the non-inverting input. Because again, what you have to observe is, there is a positive feedback. Okay, so with this we have to understand this, you know, positive negative feedback we have to understand. So there is a positive feedback. Input voltage is applied to the non-inverting input terminal. R2 and R1 are the resistors. R1 is the series resistance. R2 is the feedback resistance. Okay, fine. So in this case, what happens is that if the input voltage is positive, let us analyze this. So again, here also the voltage across R1 acts as a triggering point. Yes, let us look into this circuit also. This is with respect to voltage and current. Okay, so this is the non-inverting symmetrical circuit. Input voltage is Vi, which appears across R1. Output voltage will appear across R2. Okay. Now, the input voltage, okay, let's observe this. One more thing is, since inverting input terminal is grounded, non-inverting input terminal is at a condition called as virtual ground. So, because of this, the input voltage will appear across R1 and the output voltage will appear across R2. This input voltage, whatever we give, itself acts as a triggering point. Since input voltage is again an alternating voltage, this is again alternating voltage, this Vi, this acts as a triggering, the input voltage as well as a triggering voltage. And the output voltage is a saturating voltage. Output voltage is a saturation, you know, there is a, it is a square pulse. Output voltage is saturating, okay. Since it is a non-inverting symmetrical circuit, when the input voltage is positive, let us look into the waveform. From the waveform, we'll understand the operation of the symmetrical circuit, non-inverting symmetrical circuit. Okay. So in this case, when the input voltage is positive, let us say input voltage is increasing in the positive direction. Since it is a non-inverting amplifier, inverting input terminal is at a 0 volt, 0 potential. Differential voltage, VID, is the difference of voltage applied to non-inverting and the inverting input terminal. When the inverting input terminal, sorry, non-inverting input terminal connected to the input voltage is slightly above zero. That means, see, in this waveform, the input voltage start to rise. Okay. Differential voltage is greater than zero. If the differential voltage is slightly greater than 300 microvolts, that means if the input voltage, if this is Vi, if the input voltage is slightly greater than 300 microvolts, that is, it has just started to increase, the output voltage will switch, okay, from negative saturation to positive saturation. Why? Because it is a non-inverting amplifier. If the differential voltage is positive, output voltage is positive. If the differential voltage is less than zero, then output voltage is switches from positive saturation to negative saturation. Very simple, okay. So thereby, when this happens, you know, Initially, when the input voltage becomes slightly greater than 300 microvolts, output will switch from negative saturation to positive saturation. At some point, there is the depending on the values of R1 and R2. At some point, there is the triggering point when the input voltage reaches the triggering point. Output voltage will switch from negative saturation to positive saturation, and the input voltage continue to rise. Okay, and when it starts decreasing, that is when it goes from positive cycle to negative cycle. Okay, and when it reaches lower triggering point LTP. Output voltage will switch from positive saturation to negative saturation, and this will repeat. Okay, so in a non-inverting symmetrical circuit, what we find is output voltage is in phase with the input voltage in a non-inverting symmetrical circuit. Whereas if you see the inverting symmetrical circuit, output is 180 degree out of phase with respect to input voltage. Okay, that is, if the input voltage is positive, output voltage will be negative. Output voltage is negative. It's 180 degree out of phase because it is a inverting symmetrical circuit. Okay, operation concept remains the same, but the only difference in terms of the output voltage is in phase or out of phase with respect to input voltage. Okay, fine. So the triggering point now is voltage across R1, VR1. So this acts as a either UTP or LTP depending on whether the input voltage is positive or negative. Input voltage positive, voltage across R1 is UTP. If the input voltage is negative, or voltage across R1 is LTP. Very simple. It is calculated using this formula. VR1 is equal to V0. There is voltage across R2. Okay. Into R1, resistor R1. Because see, why it is V0 is, of course, it's very simple. By now, you guys will be knowing. If you consider the R1, one end of R1 is V0, because that is the voltage which appear across R2. This end is V0, this end is VI. Okay. So based on this, voltage across VR1 is V0 into R1 divided by sum of the resistance R1 plus R2. Okay. So based on this, we get the value of triggering point UTP or LTP depends on the output voltage, whether output voltage is positive or negative. Okay, so accordingly, UTP can be written as input voltage, which is equal to current and resistance R1. Okay. So in other words, I2 can be written as from this UTP formula, from the earlier expression, we can write from this expression. Okay. We can simplify this expression as I2. There is a current I2 is V0 divided by R, because same current will flow through the R1 and R2. So same current will flow through R1 and R2 because the input bias current is very small. Okay, so it can be neglected. It is negligible. So I2 is voltage across R1 divided by I2 is equal to voltage divided by resistance, okay, across R1. Okay, so this is I2. For I2, it is V0. Okay, because voltage across R2 is V0. Okay, I2 is equal to voltage divided by current resistance. That is, for R2, it is V0. Okay, so UTP can be written as V0 output voltage into R1 divided by R2 based on the expression I2 substituted in this expression. And rearrange, we can write it as V0 into R1. So this expression is V0 into R1 divided by R2. Very simple. Okay, so that is the expression for UTP. So that means UTP now depends on R1 and R2. See, because for first of all these three quantities are fixed quantities. Okay, for a given biasing voltage, V0 is fixed, and R1 and R2 is also fixed. But it can be varied based on the value of R1, based on the value of R1 and R2. Okay? So UTP is fixed based on the value of R1 and R2 and the output voltage. Similarly, LTP is, it's very simple using the same formula, because here we assume that UTP is equal to LTP. So for UTP is equal to LTP, LTP is given as V0 into R1 divided by R2. The only difference is for UTP, V0 will be positive. V0 will be positive, and for LTP, V0 will be negative. That's all the difference. No, otherwise the formula remains the same. LTP. What about R1 is? R1 can be found out using the triggering voltage based on the requirement. Let us say, for example, we want 2 voltage as the triggering voltage. To be more specific, we have to write only the voltage. You know, 2 voltage is triggering voltage because it is plus or minus 2 volts triggering voltage divided by the current I2. So from that we get the value of R1. So the I2 is finded for example 50 micro amperes. 50 micro. So from that we can find out the value of R2. V0 by I2. Very simple. The design is very simple, guys. You know. Okay. Adjustment. Similar to what we had adjustment for the inverting symmetrical circuit. Now adjustment for the non-inverting symmetrical circuit. Okay. Very simple. Diode D1 in series with R2. What will happen is for a positive cycle. For example, let us input if the output voltage is positive cycle, then diode D1 will be reverse biased. Guess it's something like this. Input voltage is a sinusoidal signal. Okay. Okay, so let me check the waveform. My waveform is not clear. Okay. Okay. So now when the input voltage is positive cycle, the current will flow like this. Diode D1 is forward biased. And because of this, output voltage exists. Okay, during the negative cycle, what happens is that diode D1 will be reverse biased. The diode, when the diode D1 is reverse biased, what happens is that voltage at this point becomes zero. Voltage at this point becomes zero. V0 will become zero. That means LTP becomes zero. Why? Diode D1 is reverse biased. Voltage across R2 will be zero because disconnects. Diode D1 will disconnect R1 and R2, and then LTP becomes zero when diode D1 is reverse biased. When the diode D1 is forward biased, it gives UTP, upper triggering point across the R1, upper triggering point across R1. Okay. In this arrangement, additional resistor R2 and R3, and additional diodes D1 and D2. For input positive cycle, diode D1 is forward biased, and the UTP is given by a combination of R1 and R2. When the input cycle is negative cycle, diode D2 is forward biased because output voltage is negative. Okay, because it is a non-inverting symmetrical circuit, if the input voltage is negative, output voltage is also negative saturation. When during negative saturation, diode D1 is reverse biased. Correct. Okay, negative saturation. Okay, diode D2 is for positive saturation. Okay, correct. With respect to input, I'm confused with respect to output. Okay, with respect to input, when the input is negative cycle, diode D1 is reverse biased, diode D1 is forward biased. Okay, and then it gives LTP using resistors R1 and R3. Okay, so UTP is given by combination of R1 and R2 for UTP. Using R1 and R2, and for LTP it is R1 and R3. Okay, that's how it is. So that will give the values of UTP and LTP. Very simple. Okay, so UTP is given by again the diode. Because of the diode, there is a voltage drop across the R2. So voltage drop across R2 is now affected because of the voltage drop across the diode. Okay, earlier in the absence of diode, it is only V0. Now it is V0 minus Vf, because in this network there are two voltages. It is V0 minus Vf. Vf is the forward voltage drop across the diode D1. Okay, yeah. So UTP is equal to V0 minus Vf into R1 divided by R2. Okay, it's very simple. Okay, in the guess from the previous formulas, V0 is replaced with V0 minus Vf for both UTP as well as LTP. But the other difference is for UTP, the denominator is R2 because R1 and R2 are in series. LTP R1 and R3 comes into picture because R1 and R3 is in series. R2 will be blocked out because of the reverse biasing of a diode D1. That's it. Very simple, yes, sir. It's very simple. Design of a non-inverting symmetrical circuit for UTP 3 volts and LTP 5 volts, minus 5 volts. So different UTP and LTP. Biasing voltages plus or minus 15 volts. Okay, yeah, it's the same procedure. Current 500 microamperes. So we have to assume that the diode has a sufficient forward diode, forward the connection of the diode. Forward current is sufficient enough to forward bias the diode, so that resistor values selected will be lesser. That's the idea, basically. Okay. So current I2 is at least 500 microamperes. Earlier we used to select current as 550 nanoamperes. If you remember, 550 nanoamperes. Now the current should be at least 500 microamperes, because there is a diode. We assume the current to be at least 500 microamperes. So VR1 is UTP, that is 3 volts. R1 is VR1 divided by I2. So from that we get 6 kilo ohm, 5.6 kilo ohm. That's okay. I2, okay. Now since R1 is changed, we are selecting different value for R1 than the calculated value. I2 should be recalculated. It is VR1, that is 3 volts, divided by R1, that is 5.6 kilo ohm. So it gives 536 microamperes. Earlier we assumed it as 500 microamperes. Now it is 536 microamperes. Okay. So from this VR2. So for VR2, we have to find out V0 minus VF. It's around V0 minus V0 is saturation voltage, 1 volt less than the biasing voltage, minus 0.7 volt. It's around 13.3 volts. So and hence R2 is VR2 divided by I2. I2 using the recalculated value of I2. That is 536 microamperes. It is around 24.8 kilo ohms. Okay. Now, what happens for this is that if you see the, just a second, I'll open the resistor table. Standard, just a second. Okay, so just a second, I'll open standard. Resistor capacitor tab. Okay, so from that we will find out the closer value for the 24.8 kilo ohms. Okay, so in 5% tolerance table. Okay, so the value is what's the value? Guess calculated value. It is 24.8 kilo ohms. So for 24.8 kilo ohm range, 24.8 is somewhere here. 24.8 kilo. 24.8 kilo ohms. Okay, so selection choices are 24 kilo ohms or 27 kilo ohms. Okay, fine. What happens if either one of them is selected? Okay, if either one of them is selected, if 20, okay, let us say for example, if only 24 kilo ohm is selected, okay, it becomes very less. You know, what will happen is that it is less than 24.8 kilo ohm. So if that means if R2 reduces. I2 reduces. If I2 reduces, R1 increases. Okay, so the ultimate effect of all this is that if 24 kilo is selected, UTP and LTP will not be as required. So in this case, UTP is 3 volts and LTP is minus 5 volts. It will not be so if 24 kilo is selected in place of 24.8 kilo ohms. The other choice is use one. Two fixed resistors. One is of 22 kilo ohms. If you see the standard resistor table, the next standard below lesser standard value is 22 kilo ohms, and one more 2.7 kilo ohms. 22 plus 2.7 kilo ohms is approximately 24.7 kilo ohms. 24.7. Okay. So which is very close to, of course not equal to, but very close to 24.8 kilo ohms. 24.8 kilo ohms. So select this value as the resistor for the R2. Okay, fine. But now for LTP is a separate design, because it is minus 5 volts. It is minus 5 volts. But okay, magnitude does not matter. It is anyway, negative cycle is minus 5 volts. It is understood. Okay. So for this, we have to select, we have to design the value of R3. Because, this R3, this will select the value of LTP. This will affect LTP load triggering point. So we have to consider the current through R3 and R1. Okay, so we have to design the values of R3 and R1. Okay, so R3 to start with. Where it is somewhere here. R3. Yeah, here it is. R3. Okay, is it, LTP. Okay, R3. So IR3 voltage across R1 divided by because same current I3 will flow through R1 and R3, and then so first R1 is calculated using the value of current I3. There is a sorry to set the value of I3 using VR1. Now VR1 is 5 volts because the lower triggering point is 5 volt, which appears across R1. I3 is 893 micro amperes. So from this I3, VR3 is calculated. VR3 is of course as usual V0 minus VF. It is 13.3 volts. It is same as that for the UTP also. So R3 is VR3 divided by I3 is around 14.9 kilo-ohms. So if you see the standard value again, 14.9 kilo-ohm, the standard resistor value is somewhere here. Okay, 14.9. So the lower standard value is 13 kilo-ohm and the higher standard value is 15 kilo-ohm, which is very close to calculated value. Okay, so we make use of 15 kilo-ohm as a standard resistor value for R3. Now the condition for the selection of diode, D1 and D2, reverse voltage should be greater than VCC. In this case, it is plus. It can go up to 30 volts. It should be able to withstand up to 30 volts. Okay? So reverse recovery time should be 1/10 of minimum pulse width. This is a must. Otherwise, it can be very very slower. Switching speed will be slower, and hence recovery time should be very very small. Okay? So write the final circuit diagram, insert the value of R1 and R2 and R3. In fact, here it is given as R2 as a single value, but actual circuit diagram should be series resistance for R2. That is, one is 22 kilo ohms and the other one should be 2.7 kilo. So total it should be 24.7 kilo. So it should be represented as a two series resistance for R2 rather than a single resistance. 2.7 kilo ohms. So R3 is a fixed resistance of 15 kilo ohms. Yes, okay. So this is the non-inverting schematic circuit. Actual UTP and LTP for the. Okay, so for selected standard resistance values. So in this problem, what is the change here? For the selected value of. Okay. Oh yes, yes. For the design value of resistance. What is the modified value of UTP for the R2 and R3? R2 is only 24.7 kilo-ohm. It is not 24.8 kilo-ohm. It is only 24.7. So for that R2, I2 is 538 microamperes. UTP is not equal to 3 volts. It is 3.02 volts. Okay. Similarly, the I3. Okay, with the same value of resistance for R3 it is 15 kilo-ohms. So R3 15 kilo-ohms gives I3 as 887 microamperes. LTP, of course, since it is very close, LTP happens to be equal to approximately equal to 5 volts minus 5 volts. There is only slight change in the LTP, UTP instead of 3 volts, it is 3.002 volts. Of course, small value can be ignored, but it is not exactly equal to 3 volts. LTP is very close to 5 volts. As expected, as designed. Okay, so this is the design of a non-inverting Schmitt trigger circuit. Okay, in the next class we'll continue with the converter circuit, voltage to current and current to voltage converters. I don't know whether I took the screenshot. Yes, hold on a second. Don't exit and check the attendance because it was what is the value? Was 50 or something, what? Let me take one more screenshot. Okay, here we go. Okay. Thank you. See you all. Take care. Bye. Bye. Are you from the government? ಮಧ್ಯಾಹ್ನ